Hey folks, Dagan here from PMTVUK and welcome to a brand new music news series. This is DGN, a weekly show where we'll be talking about all the exciting new guitar gear that's landed that week, as well as other beautiful musical goodies. Music news, what's happening in the world that's rocking and rolling around us as we speak. I'll also be chatting about all the cool stuff that's landed here at PMT that week, letting you know why I love it so much and why you should seriously consider checking it out. And finally, I'm going to give you guys, you the viewer, your chance to get your content on PMTVUK on this channel for the world to enjoy. More about that later. So let's start by talking about the awesome new guitar goodies that have landed this past week. The first thing I want to talk about is a guitar which has really, really piqued my interest and I can't wait to get my hands on one. It's one of the new Gibson USA Tony Iommi Signature SG Specials. Now you could be watching this thinking, this has been out for ages, they released it in 2020, stop being so ridiculous. That was a super limited edition, perfect custom shop Gibson fancy thousands and thousands of pounds variant. Exactly the same as Tony's original Monkey SG. This one is a Gibson USA standard, so it's nowhere near the price as the custom shop one, and it's going to be a solid model in the Signature series. And to look at, they're pretty similar. Obviously the custom shop one is aged and is a perfect replica of Iommi's iconic 1964 SG Special, affectionately called Monkey because it's got the little monkey playing the ukulele sticker on it. This new variant also comes with that, but the specs are slightly different. Obviously, they're both SGs, both lovely mahogany construction SGs and that iconic cherry finish. It also comes in left-handed as well, which is a great feature because Iommi's left-handed, if people didn't already know that, but Gibson have a habit of not making a lot of left-handed variants. But anyways, the differences. Obviously, it's not aged, but drag it behind your car for a little while and get it to look exactly the same as Mr. Tony's. It hasn't got the stop bar tailpiece holes because it has a slightly unique bridge on this SG Special, which Tony enjoys. It hasn't got the custom shop USA hand-wound Iommi pickups, but it does have wax-parted P90s, which are absolutely fantastic. And you can nail an Iommi tone with a Gibson USA P90, no problem at all. It's got a rounded C profile neck, lovely Indian rosewood fretboard with 22 frets, and it's a 12-inch radius, so a very familiar Gibson fingerboard. It's all bound up the neck as well. It's not as varnished. Well, it's not varnished whereas the original custom shop one was, because Iommi put lacquer varnish on the fingerboard. One, to make it look really shiny and it looks really, really sexy. But two, the fact that people might not know Iommi, Black Sabbath, one of the most legendary guitar players on the planet, who's written some of the heaviest, most badass riffs anyone's ever heard, doesn't have the use of his fingertips. He cut his fingertips off when he was a youngster, and when he worked in a factory manufacturing car parts, I believe a big steel press came down and cut his fingertips off. So he made little leather thimbles and actually plays riffs with these little leather fingertips that he made himself back in the day. So Paranoid, Iron Man, all these iconic riffs, played without the use of fingertips, and that's why he lacquered his fretboard to make it slidier for him. This one hasn't got that, but just put some lacquer on yourself. I can't wait to get my hands on this guitar because guitars make you feel a certain way. And it might not look the same as the 10 grand custom shop one, but it's the vibe is there, the feel is there, it has the monkey sticker in it, and you know it's an Iommi model, so Sabbath riffs will sound better on that guitar than any other guitar. Because it's in your head, it's how guitar players work, but it's a lot of fun. I can't wait to get my hands on it. All hand-wired electronics, the same orange drop capacitors as the custom shop Monkey. It's going to be a sight to behold, and I'm going to get copyrighted to hell and back when I film with it, because I'm just going to have to play every single legendary Black Sabbath riff under the sun. For more information and to pre-order one yourself, there's a link in the description box down below. Next up, something I can't wait to try, the new Headrush MX5. This was released onto the world a couple of days ago, and it's really piqued my interest because I'm a modeler user myself. And the reason people start using modelers is because every venue in the world has stairs. So carrying a Marshall stack up the stairs hurts your back after a while. So the whole point of modelers is to streamline your entire rig into something like a pedal board. But that's even getting too big. People want small pedal boards, ease of use, with great sounds. And other brands like Helix have the HX Stomp, Boss had the GT1000, then the smaller GT1000 Core. This is the smallest new effects and amp modeler from Headrush, the MX5. When the original Headrush was released a couple of years ago, and the gig board as well, it kind of blew everyone away because it obviously has the touchscreen. It does everything that everyone enjoys, all the amps and effects and stuff, but the touchscreen was a big feature. This new MX5 has the touchscreen as well, but a lot of people thought it was going to be a bit of a gimmick. Until you plugged one in. so cool. These things sound fantastic. Originally, like a development on the old 11 rack, which was used by so many pro artists back in the day. They've taken that technology and absolutely advanced the living hell out of it. And everyone adores the Headrush stuff. Akai and Headrush. Headrush have done a fantastic job of making these things sound fantastic. And now you can get that in a tiny little board. I don't know how big it is. I've never actually held one, but I'm guessing about yay big. It has a 4-inch touchscreen. It has an expression pedal, which you don't get on the HX Stomp or the 1000 Core by Boss. It features two separate control knobs if you don't want to use the fantastic, very intuitive screen to change parameters, move amplifiers around and all that kind of stuff. But the screen's great, it's super quick and the resolution is awesome. It's like having a little iPhone on your pedal board, and aesthetically, it's very pleasing to move the knobs actually on like a Marshall or Mesa Boogie thing. Anyways, three separate foot switches as well, which you can assign to do anything you want. Obviously out the box, it does what it says, moves through rigs, turns on choruses or overdrives, whatever you want, but you can assign these little three foot switches to do whatever you want. Because of the screen and the interface, it's been dubbed in the US already the easiest and most powerful small multi-effects system on the market. There's 50 guitar and bass amplifiers in it, so you can use it with bass as well, 15 bass and guitar cabs, 10 mics and 66 glorious effects, going from super simple ones like overdrive and delay to ring modulators. There's a built-in looper. It can be used as a stereo effects. Well, there's a stereo effects extend in and out, two of them, because it's stereo, so you can use it with other effects, rack mount stuff if you want, and it's totally USB compatible, so you can use it as an interface and get the tones from your Headrush MX-5 into your recording software, or you can reamp it at a later date. This thing is going to be awesome. Again, a link to the description box down below. And be sure to get your fine self subscribed to this here PMTV UK on YouTube to be the first to see my rundown and review and demo of the Headrush MX-5. I think it could be a game changer for me because I kind of want to slim down my modeling rig anyways. So Headrush, I'm excited to try one. Now is a part of the show where I chat about all the cool stuff that's actually landed here at PMT this week, as opposed to just getting released onto the world. There might already be the video live on YouTube with this pedal. But I think it's fantastic. It's the new Lil Rat, the tiny ProCo Rat from the fine folk at ProCo. So this is a regular size rat, and this is the new Little Rat. It has exactly the same tones, feel, punch, percussiveness to it. We can go from a lovely light overdrive to distortion to full-on fuzz, but it's only 2 inches big. It's literally the most fun you can have with 2 inches. Don't add anything onto that. So the Rat is an iconic pedal. I would put the Rat in the same category as like the Klon Center and the original Tube Screamer. It's a must-have for guitar players out there. When you want an overdrive in your collection, which does everything and sounds very unique, so it's not like a, it's not copying another pedal, it's not a modified version of a Tube Screamer or a full transparent overdrive like a Klon. It's its own thing, the Rat, and the cool thing is, it's never cost a lot of money. These things have always been very affordable and they deliver on all the tones from rock and metal all the way through to blues and everything in between. And look at it, it's just adorable. It's made from the same, heavy duty material as the original Rat. Rats will outlive all of us. Not only are they rock solid, but the circuit board inside is a military grade epoxy circuit board. So again, it's gonna outlive all of us. There's no battery compartment on this though, so it only runs on 9-volt power, but I don't really know any pedal boards out there which run on batteries anymore. Everyone's got their own power supplies. And real estate is key on pedal boards. Pedals are getting smaller, but pedal boards are getting bigger. So I know for a fact, there's definitely space on your pedal board for the Lil Rat. Check it out, it's linked down below. Next up is a guitar which scares me a little bit because I'm demoing it very, very soon. And this isn't my kind of style of playing at all. I hope Van Halen riffs sound great on this guitar, but I love the player and I love all the bands he's in. This is the new Fender Cory Wong signature Stratocaster with very flappy tags. So again, funk playing isn't usually my forte, but what I love about this guitar is the fact that they haven't just taken a Strat and put someone's name on it and then claimed it's a signature Strat. There's so many cool, unique features about this guitar which make it unique to be the Cory Wong Strat. If you're unfamiliar with Cory Wong, he is an absolute funk machine. His own solo stuff, his stuff with Wolfpack, he lives in the pocket. He's always on time. He's got such a unique percussive playing style which is beautiful and clean, so he's very well deserving of a signature blue Strat. The first thing you might notice, well, I'm a big guy anyway, so Strats look small, but the Strat body, this lovely Alder body, is actually smaller. So the body is shaved down because he likes playing a slightly smaller body size. Size-wise, it's similar to a Jackson Dinky, however, it's not pointy and it's not Jackson-ish, it is just a proper Fender Strat. Pickup-wise, it has the clean machine signature Cory, Wong, Seymour, Duncan pickups in, three-way switch, one volume, one tone, and a push-pull control on the tone control, which activates as like a panic button. He loves position four, so the neck and the middle pickup. It's an iconic Strat tone. But when you're rocking out on stage, sometimes it's quite hard to get in position four. So when you push this, no matter what position you're in, it takes you to that position. So rocking in the bridge pickup, there's a solo coming, I need to go in the neck and the middle. Give the bottom tone control a whack, you can panic bypass to that position and then go back to the bridge, just or wherever you want to be, just by tapping the tone control again. That's a cool feature. It's got an awesome sculpted neck heel as well. So not only is it curved that way, it's curved on the body like the American Ultras, which he's very, very keen on. Maple neck, it's a slim D profile neck, the same as the D American Ultras, but it feels different to me. It feels wide, but thin. Kind of like if an Ibanez and a Fender had a baby. Compound radius, so it's curved down the bottom and flattens right towards the top. Rosewood fingerboard, great for chord stuff when you want to shred away like Cory does. You're not going to get choked out on any curved fingerboard. There's locking tuners with Cory's name on the back of the headstock. If you didn't know what you're looking at, it looks like a blue, lovely satin blue Strat, but there's a lot of cool features which make it unique to Cory Wong. And because of that, I'm really enjoying the fact that Fender have done this. And like, instead of, like I said at the start, just putting another name on yet another Stratocaster. Link for this in the description box down below. Now for this week's music news. Firstly, big old John Mayer has released a video for Wild Blue, one of my favorite songs off his new album, Sob Rock. Yet another awesome 80s inspired song with a ridiculously amazing 80s inspired video to go along with it. The best way I can explain it is comically nostalgic. It is a bit of a jab at 80s style videos, as was Shot in the Dark, the previous single and the previous video. But because John is such an incredible musician, it's pulled off with so much tact and so much class that you can laugh but also enjoy the song for being the song as it is. He's rocking his satin mock sand PRS Silver Sky in the video with a black DiMarzio clip lock strap and a gorgeous oversized big shoulder padded jacket, like a tan jacket, pulled straight from the 80s along with his tiny little glasses. Now, what's cool about this is John, obviously, ridiculously big guitar collection, so many vintage guitars it will make your jaw hit the deck, as well as a plethora of Dumbles, Soldanos, vintage Fenders modified by Alessandro, and everything in between. He uses a Fractal Axe FX 3 to get the solo sound on the setting Studio Clean, which is a factory preset you get in the Fractal Axe FX 3. Now, John was seen using the Axe FX 3 at a festival last year, or the year before, I believe, and it's quite cool to see him using that on the album, because you can be a bit of a pompous, oh, I only play through Clones and Dumbles and vintage Stratocasters. He's rocking his PRS through his Fractal Axe FX rig, and it sounds, tell any purist out there that it's a super reverb, and they'll be like, oh yeah, it sounds great. So that's what he's using. But back to the video, I'll link it down below. It starts opening a door at the bottom of a swimming pool, then you see John in that trench coat with his cowboy boots and his tortoiseshell sunglasses playing his PRS. While violins float by, there's chameleons, there's plants and flowers blooming straight from the dirt. He's playing in front of a green screen. I love a good green screen. It's a bit more high budget than New Light though, the New Light video from a couple of years ago. Bit more high budget, and what he's playing in front of, like the sunsets and oceans crashing and beautiful space scenes. If John wasn't there and Sob Rock was a lot more heavy metal, you could mistake this for a Tool video. John Mayer has such an amazing sense of humor, and Wild Blue is a hell of a song and hell of a video. Please comment down below what you think of the song or what your favorite song is off Sob Rock. It's a bit of a departure from his bluesy past and Search for Everything, but Carry Me Away is probably my favorite song, followed by Wild Blue, and then Who Doesn't Love a Bit of New Light. Now, the guitar world has been shaken up this week. Serious topic now, actually. DIMEBAG Darrel has left Dean Guitars. This is a very touchy subject, this whole thing, so I'm going to tiptoe around it as much as I can, because there's a lot of moving parts, a lot of he said this, she said that, a lot of hearsay. But yeah, DIMEBAG, before his untimely passing in December 2004, joined Dean Guitars again after a lengthy stint at Washburn, when previously he was known from the Dean from Hell and the Far Beyond Driven Dean. He was back with Dean just before his untimely death. And as a huge, huge Pantera and Damage Plan fan, I thought this was fantastic because he's back to the Dean from Hell's coming back, the Far Beyond Driven. I've got one of the Far Beyond Driven Deans in my collection and it's awesome. But obviously Dean Dimebag was murdered on stage in December 2004 and it absolutely sucks. But he's been with Dean ever since. Dean have helped carry the legacy of Dimebag Darrel through all of these years. However, a couple of days ago, Rita, Dime's longtime girlfriend, pretty much personal assistant, and the woman in charge of his endorsements at the time, because they knew each other so well, she was always looking out for Dimebag. Rita was as stoked as anyone when Dean and Dime finally got together. It was like family was coming back together. The reason I'm talking about this right now is because literally, you say Dean from Hell, you say Dean ML, you think of Dimebag and Pantera and Damage Plan, so it's ingrained in us guitarists to know that Dean and Dimebag and stuff is all one collective thing. However, they're no longer together. So when Dime passed, unfortunately he didn't have a will. So instead of everything going in Rita's control, which it had been for years previous, it went to his next of kin, which was of course the legendary drummer from another mother that is Vinnie Paul Abbott, one of the best drummers on the planet. Again, RIP, Pantera, hell yeah, Damage Plan. This dude is a beast and he was in control of the Dime-Dean relationship after Dime's passing. And it wasn't until, unfortunately, Vinnie Paul passed away a couple of years ago that Rita and the Dimebag Estate, like the Dimebag Trust that she has a big part in, keeping the memory of Dimebag alive, saw that Dean might have been not as nice as they could have been. Again, I don't know. This is a genuine lawsuit that's happening right now, so I don't really know the full extent. So she was like, right, you're not honoring Dimebag the way you intended to. Dimebag had the trademarks for the Razorback and the Stealth. Dean obviously created the ML back in the day. Dean Zielinski started Dean in 1977 and started all these fantastic guitars, very, very close friends with Dime. Dean Zielinski left Dean Guitars in 2008, I believe, after being away for a little while. He came back, then went away again. And everyone now is saying this Dimebag and that. If Dime was still alive, he would have left with Dean Zielinski. So yeah, Rita has seen that they haven't been upholding their part of the bargain and using some trademarks without actually asking the Dimebag Estate. So now she's filing a lawsuit. Dean have came out and put their side of the story forward, which is a totally legitimate response to everything Rita said. We'll just have to wait and see how this pans out. It's a shame that Dimebag and Dime isn't going to be with Dean anymore. But this kind of leaves the door open to, is there going to be a Dimebag guitar company made from the Dimebag estate, the Dimebag family, the Dimebag trust, everything going there? There's also talk, well, I've seen people wishing that it will go to Wild Audio Guitars, Zach Wild's guitar company, because Zach Wild and Dimebag Darrel were the best of best friends back in the day. So I think it would be an honor for Zach to make some Dimebag guitars and have his best mate's name on the headstock. They're obviously made by Schecter, which means they're available to everyone, these Wild Audio guitars. That'd be very, very cool. Comment down below your thoughts on the matter. If you want to add anything, please do. And where would you like to see Dimebag guitars made in the future? It's a bit of a heavy subject, I know, but the whole guitar world is talking about it at the minute, so I could not put it in the first episode of DGN. Now, here is where you can get involved. The amount of support this channel has had over the past few years has been absolutely phenomenal. From small beginnings a few years ago to now smashing through 235,000 followers and it's only growing from there. We want to give back, so we want to include some awesome videos from yourselves. There'll be an email address on screen right now. Please submit videos of yourselves unboxing guitars. If you want to do a little review and demo in the style of me of your favorite guitar, do it. If you want to show me your favorite riff, if it's from a famous band out there, or your favorite riff from your band, please send the video and the email to the email address on screen right now. Let me know if I can use your name, your Instagram handle, I'll tag your band, I'll tag you, I'll tell people to check you out. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to give back to you guys and I want to see some of you guys rock out, demo stuff, but most of all, have the most fun in the world. It hasn't got to be anything fancy. You haven't got to mic yourself up or anything crazy like that. Just make sure it's in landscape mode as opposed to portrait, so I can put it on the lovely screen that you're watching right now. And you can get your stuff, your reviews, your favorite riffs, your favorite band's riffs to our lovely PMTVUK viewers. It's gonna be a lot of fun and I can't wait to see everyone rock out. So I hope you enjoyed that, the first episode of DGT, Dagan's Guitar News here at PMTVUK. It's been a lot of fun. Be sure to get yourself subscribed to PMTVUK for lots more awesome content like this. We have 16 stores up and down the UK. There's got to be one close to you right now. Get yourself to pmtonline.co.uk to check out stuff which is in the stores but actually on the website, which is a beautiful modern way of doing things. And we are PMT House of Rock on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and now TikTok. Give us a like and a follow over there to see pictures of these beautiful instruments, but with nice filters on. I've been Dagan. I'll see you next time.